First of all, I want to thank you for having me during this very lively and diverse conference. I'm working on a project called the Bosch Research and Conservation Project, a research project devoted to the paintings and drawings of just one person, the late medieval painter Hieronymus Bosch. This project started in 2010, finishing its first term in 2016 and starting a second term last year in 2017 that will run until 2023. I do my work at the University of Nijmegen in the Netherlands, but the project collaborates with several other institutions, of which the Noord-Brabants Museum in 's-Hertogenbosch is the most important to mention within this context. But before I come back to that collaboration, first a few words about the man himself and why we devote such an extensive project to this artist. I will walk you through the project in five steps. I will tell you a bit about the painter himself, about the way we try to document as much as possible his works, the way we go at length to help in the preservation of his work. I will tell you something about the presentation of our work and about our future aims for the project. But first of all, the painter himself. Just a quick introduction. The paintings and drawings of the Netherlandish artist Hieronymus Bosch, lived about around 1500, rank among the most creative works of art that mankind has produced. Bosch, working around 1500 in the city of 's-Hertogenbosch, the northernmost, more or less, major city in the Duchy of Brabant, now in the Netherlands, challenges the minds of those who wish to gain some understanding of his creations. And I'm just showing you a few of his examples of his work. This is a detail from the painting I just showed you in a very strange, almost mockery of the flight into Egypt that you see on the right-hand side, a print from a contemporary of Bosch, Martin Schongauer. And what Bosch does is something very weird with that iconography. This is a central piece from the Garden of Earthly Lights, a painting that is now in the Museo del Prado in Madrid. The most classical minds among us might feel uncomfortable when seeing the counter-natural hellish scenes of Bosch, for instance, this Last Judgment triptych in Vienna. And when the work of Bosch is being discussed among art historians and historians, dispute is never far away. Bosch is fast, capricious, angry, scared, humorous as well, and his work is old, more than 500 years old, and rare. Only some 25 paintings and 20 drawings survive. His work is important heritage that was made in an age of transition, that confusing period around 1500 of discovery, church reform, world empires, urbanization, and capitalism. The understanding of these artworks is often hard, but bewilderment and admiration is not. Therefore, so much literature has been produced since the rediscovery of the work of Bosch by the end of the 19th century. The Hieronymus Bosch Art Center in 's-Hertogenbosch even has a special library solely devoted to literature connected to Bosch. Unfortunately, we don't know what Bosch really looked like, since all the portraits of him that we have today are made after his death. This portrait print from around 1570 usually serves to show the man. However, we know that in these days, around 1500, a lot of painters included their own portrait into the scenes that they depicted. And as a consequence, numerous heads in the paintings by Bosch have been proposed as being self-portraits. My suggestion is pure speculation, but has the advantage of introducing to you what the project does. It's a detail from the Adoration of the Magi, nowadays in the Prado in Madrid, and it's so small that in a regular photo, or in the painting itself, when you're standing in front of it, you won't see it. And it's this couple a male had and a female, we know that Boss was married without children. If you must look for the portrait, this would be my suggestion. It is this very tiny detail right above his signature in this beautiful painting in Madrid. To the level of detail of this imagery, I come back in a minute. The work of Bosch is relevant, especially in times of uncertainty, of anxiety, and of moral dilemmas. The Heywen, a painting that might be better called The Triumph of Greed, has an iconography that was single-handedly invented by Bosch. It is a brilliant visual emulation of Petrarch's Triumphi, and the famous Renaissance poet from Italy. If Petrarch can be regarded as the inventor of humanism, Bosch can be viewed as his pupil. Bosch's Wayfarer, and this is, by the way, a book illustration from that Triumphi, with which you see the Triumph of Death, published in Venice around 1500. So it's the same type of imagery. Bosch's Wayfarer on the outside of the Heywen triptych of the Triumph of Greed is another landmark in this respect. Instead of a saint, a grisaille, imitating sculpture or something like that that you would expect on the outside of a triptych, this is a vagabond, a nobody, who is every man at the same time. This is the pilgrim of life, bending to get through his earthly existence. He too is an innovative iconography in which no hero but an ordinary and inconsiderable man is being given center stage. Isn't that the work for the 21st century? The pilgrimage of life in times of mass migration and the triumph of greed in the age of hyper-capitalism. Of course, analogies between a painting of over 500 years old and modern times cannot but fail. Times have changed immensely, and it takes hard and diligent work to understand only a little bit of those ancient times. And yet, when studied patiently, our reward is that we feel a sense of connection with the people and their culture. And that is the work of art historians and conservators, preserving our historical roots and making those roots understandable in both their familiarity and their alterity. Through our publications and exhibitions, we pull the past into the present, as been said before. In addition to these classical means, online tools have begun to play an increasingly important role in this respect, and I'll come back to that. In the Bosch Research and Conservation Project, like I said, starting in 2010, we try to combine and integrate these elements. In the first term of the project, the aim was to document and analyze all the paintings that are more or less unanimously attributed to Bosch according to a standardized protocol. And now turn to the part of the documentation. The idea behind this was that if we want to try to compare artworks, we have to have them photographed in the same way as much as possible, because we want to compare these artworks and not photographs. This is easier said than done and requires the work of a professional photographer and conservator with an interest in research. From a scientific point of view, standardized research setup is only natural, but from a practical point of view, this means trying to create similar circumstances in cultural environments that are not necessarily similar at all. Working in the Prado Museum is very different from working in the Galleria dell'Accademia in Venice or in the Gemälde Galerie in Berlin. I'll show you just a few images of what we do, how we do it. This is work on that Vienna Last Judgment with an infrared scanner. What we make is an extensive set of data. On the left-hand side, you see these infrared reflectogram scans. In the middle part, we do the same thing, but with an infrared photography, so a little bit different wavelength. And on the right-hand side, you see tiny bits of visible light photography. Now, the reason why we went to great lengths to document Bosch's paintings and drawings so extensively is that we realize that these artworks are really our primary sources, and those documents should be disclosed at a much higher level than have been done so far. Instead of high resolution image of 5,000 pixels, we can also make an image of 50,000 pixels with relative ease. And we can do that not only for images in visible light, but also in infrared, in X-ray, and other types of wavelengths. However, in order to make these accessible, some arrangements have to be made. One needs an online tool with viewers to make this work. And this for now became the BoschProject.org website. Here you see a little bit of a summary of what you get from different types of photography, and the human vision infrared that penetrates the paint layer and gives you some sense of the underdrawing. So some of the artistic genesis of a painting can be understood, and this results in different types of images. I show you a detail from St. John the Baptist in the Museo Lázaro Galdiano in Madrid. On the left-hand side, you see a painted plant in visible light, in the X-ray, but more importantly, in the infrared, you see that underneath that plant, there's actually the donor, the patron of this painting. And this makes you think about the, let's say, the societal function of a painting like this around 1500. Why was it painted, and why was it overpainted, and how did it function? So this you can see in this website, BoschProject.org, where all these data are made available, and I think it's currently the most extensive online data set for a single painter available for everyone with an internet connection. The preservation part, the conservation part of the project. Another aim of this of the BRCP is to help to keep the legacy of Bosch in good health. And this means the project funded several extensive restoration projects and provided advice during several other conservation treatments. The conservator on the team, Luc Hoogstede from Stal Maastricht, which is one of the conservation studios in the Netherlands, was a trainee at the Getty's Panel Paintings Initiative, a project in which paintings conservators with a special interest for wood were trained specifically in the structural treatment of panels. The Panel Paintings Initiative awarded the BRCP a substantial grant for the structural treatment of paintings by Bosch in Venice and Bruges. In the period 2010-2016, no less than 12 out of a group of 25 paintings were treated. Six out of those 12 restorations were made possible by the BRCP, and all treatments were carried out at the initiative and under the supervision of the institutions, the museums responsible for the paintings. A particularly extensive collaboration existed with the Accademia in Venice, where structural work on the panels was carried out by Roberto Saccomanni's trainee from the Panel Paintings Initiative, whereas Giulio Bono and his colleagues were responsible for the treatment of the painting surface. Here you see a painting, The Ship of Fools, from the Louvre Museum, on the left before treatment, in the middle part after treatment, and it turned out that that painting was a fragment of a wing of a triptych, of which the lower part is currently preserved in the Yale University Art Museum. So when all this research and preservation was done, and before the opening of the large retrospective exhibition in Sertogenbosch in February 2016, the newly restored Venetian paintings were presented in a small but focused educational exhibition in the Galleria dell'Accademia, and this is what you see here. And that was a wonderful opportunity for a general audience to make its acquaintance with the field of heritage preservation and painting conservation. We included in that exhibition several screens with these interactive viewers that you can also see on the website, and I will try to open one now. I hope that this will work. That shows you a little bit of what this website can show you. This is what we call a curtain view of the painting before treatment. It looked like this. And when you lower the curtain, this is the painting after treatment. So what we did here is we photographed this this painting in a very high resolution, which means that you can zoom in on this person quite to this degree, and compare what choices the conservator made in this respect. So this is conservators usually are not used to being put on the spot like this, but I think it helps a general audience, and they love this type of imagery, to understand what conservators do, and that paintings actually age and get dirty. And the moment when a painting after treatment is put on display in an exhibition, you have forgotten about what it looked like only a few months before, and it's nice to keep track, I think, of that. Of that past. So now I'm going to try to get back to the presentation. So it was shown in first in January in Venice, and then afterwards in the city of Zetelkenbosch. So within the larger context of the retrospective in Den Bosch, special attention was paid to what one might call the objecthood of artworks. Triptychs were presented in such a way the audience could walk around them and appreciate their three-dimensionality. Both recto and verso drawings were shown, creating the same effect. On six occasions during the itinerary, monitors showed small films, image only, in which various aspects of the physicality of paintings and drawings were presented, be it a reconstruction of a triptych, I showed you a little bit before, the discovery of hidden figures underneath the current paint layers, or a close comparison between original and copy. All these little films were only possible because of the extensive documentation that was made by the Bosch project. In this way, we connected research, conservation treatment, and the presentation of it for a larger audience. Naturally, storytelling is an important part of museums, and to art historians, telling stories is also an important way to communicate their findings, be it more verbal than the hanging of paintings, pictures in a museum. But for the conservator, who has to take care of the patient, to tell stories is not part and parcel of the job. Nevertheless, we come to learn that a large audience is attracted to and fascinated by this old stuff. People are interested in problems connected to aging. Everybody will understand that a painting of over 500 years old does not look the same as it did in the time of its conception, and that it takes care and devoted work of heritage preservers to keep these works alive. This, I believe, can be shown and communicated to a larger extent than is usually been done in art museums. And only incidentally are matters of conservation practice allowed to play a part in the art historical and museological discourse. With the Bosch Research and Conservation Project, we continuously try to bridge the world of academia, museums, and conservation studios. In our research, our writings, and exhibitions that we curate, we will always look for ways to present that objecthood of the artworks. From that objecthood, one can develop thoughts in all sorts of directions, be it iconological, sociological, economical, or anthropological. So now, this was the hanging of the painting. I'll skip that. And now for some future aims. The first term of the BRCP ended in 2016 with the publication of a two-volume monograph on Bosch exhibitions in Den Bosch and Madrid, and the publication of boschproject.org, where a large portion of the visual documentation of the project is shared online. However, several important questions still remain unanswered, and to a number of paintings the project had not been granted access in the first term, among them the large and extremely important painting This Last Judgment in Vienna. Only in the summer of 2016, so after 7 years of work, the BRCP team was invited by the director of the Academy to carry out its investigations. And this was the start of the second term of the project. We will be focusing on the findings of this research in a symposium next year, and hopefully an exhibition that will be staged then. It also learned us something about Bosch as a businessman and Bosch as a member of a family of painters. We may rightfully ask the question if it's justified to focus only on a singular genius, because Bosch ran the workshop, we knew that. So, with this second term, probably a richer historical picture can be painted, and that's what we will be trying to do in the years to come. A first essay in this direction will be an exhibition in the Nordbrabens Museum, again, devoted to the adoration of the Magi theme. The theme that Bosch painted at least two times, and led to his most copied painting, this one in Madrid. To connect with the former speaker, this is Petworth House, one of the National Trust buildings where we carried out research in the beginning of this year to one of those early and maybe even studio copies of that famous Bosch painting. So that will be presented during that exhibition that will open on the 1st of December. I will skip this part. So to back up, the Bosch Research and Conservation Project is a very focused project on the legacy of one painter and his workshop. We approach the artworks as the primary sources of our investigations and explore the objectivity of those artworks. We go at length to document the paintings and drawings as meticulously as we can in a standardized way so that they can be compared to one another. And we try to help when the objects need more active care, conservation treatment. And apart from communicating our findings through written, printed publications and exhibitions, we, like so many of us, as we have seen in the wonderful presentation during this conference, believe that online tools can be a forceful instrument in the presentation and preservation of this cultural heritage. And that is why we put our data, all our research data, online and available for all. And this will hopefully inspire future art historians as well to produce new narratives about these great works of art, narratives that you can come up with yourself. I will turn to this once more and conclude by showing you where this is. And again, he's here. It's a very beautiful detail. I thank you very much for your attention.